I'm trying a new trick this semester. Usually I try to write all your exams before the semester starts, but I got busy. So instead, what I'm going to do is just write your exams as the topics come up with my lecture. And so this weekend, I wrote an exam question similar to what we did before. We've done this before. I'm going to do it again, and then there's one more point I want to make with this, which is interesting. Down. This is exactly the example we did on Wednesday. So you've got this part in your notes already. Giving you a matrix, I'm asking the two most important subspaces associated with that matrix are the column space and the null space. Remember, the column space is everything that we can write as linear combinations of the columns. The null space is all the vectors that this sends to zero. So what vectors is? Notice that each column here has four components. So the column space lives in R4 in a four-dimensional space. There's no way we're going to have five linearly independent vectors in a four-dimensional space. And if I have five vectors, some of those are going to be redundant. Finding a basis is finding a non-redundant list of vectors that spans the entire space. You get all those words mean? So some of the, I'm going to just pull out some of these columns. And remember that linear independence transfers across elementary row operations. So do you see that column 2 can be built out of column 1? I see over here that column 2 is 2 times column 1. And I see over here that column 2 is 2 times column 1. So the linearly independent columns in this matrix are column 1 and column 3. I can't build column 3 out of these two because of this one. And I can build column 4 out of 1 and 3. I can build this column 4 out of 1 and 2. So my basis for the column space is the first and the third columns. So far, so good. Asking for a basis for the null space. Think about this as representing the left part of an augmented matrix for a system of equations. We have 0 here, that's x1, x2, x3, x4, x5. That would be the equation for the top line. That second line transformed into an equation give me this. I'm going to give a mathematical description of all the vectors to make this true. X4 is t, x5 is t, x4 is s, is 4s minus 5t, x2 is that free choice, and x1 is minus 2r minus 3s plus. Okay, I'm going fast through this. You've seen it before, so I want you to get the general idea of I can parameterize the infinitely many solutions to this equation, which gives me a nice mathematical description of all the vectors in the null space. And then I can split this up by parameter. All the calculations we did last time. Here's a basis for the column space of A. So this is the most efficient set of building blocks that can make everything in the column space. What's the dimension of the column space?
Two.
And the dimension of the null space?
Three.
I'm going to focus on those dimensions right now. So first of all, the way we got our vectors in the column space was in the reduced row echelon form of the matrix, finding the columns that are linearly independent. We knew we needed this one is because I can't build this entry out of the previous ones. So whenever I have a leading one in the reduced row echelon form of the matrix, then that's going to give me a column in the original matrix to put in the column space. So here we have, I'm going to erase this part. No, I'm not. Is going to be the number of leading ones in the reduced row echelon form of the matrix. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through this matrix. In every leading one, remember a leading one is the first non-zero entry in the row, is going to be a linearly independent vector. So each leading one is going to give me a corresponding column over here for a vector in the column space. Each leading one gives me a vector. The number of vectors is the dimension. So the dimension of the column space is the number of leading ones that I have in the reduced row echelon form of the matrix. And you remember we actually had a name for the number of leading ones in the reduced row echelon form?
Right.
That's the rank. Notice that when I'm building a basis for the null space of A, is I get one vector for each parameter. We had three free choices here. So those free choices are a parameter, split by parameter and factor out. Each parameter gives us a vector in the null space, the basis for the null space. And notice where the free choices occur. X5 was free, X4 was 3, X3 was forced. What else was forced? X1, X2, X3. So the forced variables are exactly the ones with the leading one. So if a column is not a leading one, then that's going to be a free choice. So the number of vectors in the basis for the null space is going to be the number of free choices we have here, which is going to be the number of columns that don't have a leading one.
What about the cases where we have like a constant vector that doesn't have a variable, like on the exam? Like,
oh yeah, so remember, it's we're looking for a basis for the null space,
yeah.
And whenever it's the null space, it's zeros here, so there's not going to be
a constant. There wouldn't be.
That's all right. So as I'm going through the columns of the reduced row echelon form of the matrix, I might have a leading one. If I have a leading one, I can come back here and find a vector in the basis for the column. It's not a leading one, in which case it was a free choice. That parameter is going to generate a vector in the null space. So this adds a vector to a basis for the column space, adds a vector for the basis of the null space, column space, null space, null space. So you see that each column either puts a vector here or puts a vector there. So what we have is, if I do the dimension of the column space and add the dimension of the null space, I'm going to get the number of columns of A. The number of columns of A is the dimension of the column space plus the dimension of the null space. I'm going to say two more things. I think that's probably a slightly better definition of the word rank. It's equivalent to what I had. So the dimension of the column space is the number of leading ones, which I call the rank. And in my mind, when I think of the rank of a matrix, I think of the size of the column space. And then this has a word. This is called the nullity of the matrix. Nice succinct way to say that is the rank of a matrix plus the nullity of that matrix is equal to the number of columns. I'll just throw this out there. This is sometimes, every subject has its fundamental theorem. There's fundamental theorem of calculus relating the derivative and the integral. It's linear algebra has its fundamental theorem. There's four parts, and this is considered part one of the fundamental theorem of linear algebra. So I feel good about this. Special graph paper that I gave you last time. You still have that. I think I read it on my copy. You can follow along. got one more. You're gonna share with her. I know, actually. Okay, sounds good. Oh, she's gonna take a picture. You can share with. And then pass it out. And don't worry too much. We did most of the work on this last time. I just wanna point this out. Oh, excellent. Cool. Let's see. This is, you get that, and then you get that. There you go. I've got two coordinate systems, both centered at this origin here. It's my normal x, y. And when I give you, I have a second coordinate system I'm calling x hat and y hat. To describe a coordinate system, it's I have to give you two vectors. The direction of the vector tells you what the direction of that axis is. And the length of the vector represents a tick. So you'll notice that this vector here completely describes the x-hat axis. If there's the direction, in one unit is the length of that vector. And then there's some point, which I will do in orange. Up here. There's two ways to describe this point. So if I'm moving along the normal xy system, that point is over 3, up 4. But another way to describe that point is I can move in this x hat direction and then this y hat direction. So I can get to that same point by moving 2 in the x hat direction and 1 in the y hat direction. So again, the point is just out there, and how I describe the point is I can describe it relative to the coordinate system I'm using. So, do this. Now I need one more color. Yeah, just the black. We'll call this back. S is, I call the standard basis. So right now, just think about S as representing the normal XY coordinate system. And then I made up a new coordinate system I'm going to call X hat, Y hat. Then, it's this vector B. If I want to write the coordinates of B relative to the standard coordinate system, it's the usual over 3, up 4. That exact same point can be represented in the x hat, y hat system. It's 2 units in the x hat direction, and then 1 unit in the y hat. Big picture, and it's, I've got two different coordinate systems. you give me a point out here, I can describe it relative to the first coordinate system, I can describe it relative to the second coordinate system. We did some practice with those in the last class. So we've got a shorthand way of writing this. So if I write the coordinates of B are 3, 4, what I'm really talking about is 3 units in the standard x direction, 4 units in the standard. Standard basis is usually defined to be this. And then is I'm going to describe my new basis in terms of vectors. And those vectors will be described in terms of the standard basis. So my x hat, 1 unit in the x hat direction is described how with regular x and y's. Looks like it's 2 more. So again, always think about you've got the standard basis as the background. And then you're going to describe this new basis with respect to the standard basis. And once you have that, you can work everything out. So 2, 1, that's the x hat, and then the y hat. And you have to look at your paper. So describe your y hat as an over and an up. Is it negative 2?
Negative 1.
Yes. Positive 1?
Negative 1.
Negative 1, positive 2? Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's. What was it? What did you say? Negative 1, positive 2? Let me point out something here. I don't need to memorize this yet. I'll write this down. As we go on in this class, we're going to have transformations. We're going to make custom coordinate systems based on the transformation, so it's easier to understand the transformation. And if you're lucky, the best coordinate systems have perpendicular axes. So our regular x and y perpendicular here? Yeah. Is our new basis, are these blessings? Are these perpendicular?
Yes.
Okay. I think this was a nice one. Sometimes we're going to have a non-perpendicular basis and it'll still work. But for now, we're going to stick with that perpendicular basis. So if I tell you that the coordinates of B relative to this new basis are 2, 1. Actually, no, let's back up. So the coordinates of B relative to S are 3, 4. What that means is if I go 3 units along the x-axis, and then 4 units along the y-axis, I end up at 3, 4. If I tell you the coordinates of B relative to my new basis are 2, 1, that means if I do 2 units in the x-hat direction, and then 1 unit in the y-hat direction, I'm going to get my B vector. So what's the x-hat direction? 2, 1, that's what we have right here. And the y hat direction, negative 1, 2. So this is 4 minus 1 is 3, and 2 plus 2 is 4. the same vector, and so I can get the v coordinates, I can get the s coordinates, and somehow those coordinates are related to each other. So I'm going to just do this algebraically now. Same v. Some vector I'm looking at, I want you to find the s coordinates. I'm going to draw the picture, and then we're just going to work this out arithmetically. So remember what this means? Is this means go negative 1 in the x half direction, and then 2 in the y half. So on the picture, it's negative 1 in the x half direction, and then 2 in the y hat direction. And what am I asking for? I'm asking, how would you get to this exact same point if you did it in terms of normal x and y's? Was it negative 4 and 3? So based on the picture, it looks like it should be negative 4 and 3. Let's work it out our way. So this says negative 1 in the x hat direction plus 2 in the y hat. What's the x hat direction? What's x hat? 2, 1. Y hat is negative 1, 2. Negative 4, 3. Describe this point in the x hat, y hat coordinates. So graphically, it means minus 1 in the x hat direction and then 2 in the y hat. I can describe this exact same point in terms of x and y. Based on the picture, it's negative 4 back and 3 up. We can also do this arithmetically by knowing the standard coordinates of. Did you do another one? You got a funny look on your face.
Yeah, what do you mean the standard coordinates of B? What is that?
Oh, so what I mean is if you want to describe this in terms of x, y.
No, where did you get the, yeah, the 2, 1, negative 1, 2?
That 2, 1 is the standard coordinates of x hat.
Oh, gotcha.
Do this one for me. So I'm going to get to my v vector by 3 in the x hat direction and then 4 in the y hat. And tell me how to get to that same point with regular x and regular y. This says is these these are the build, these are the instructions for using these building blocks to get to my vector b. It says if I do 3 times the first vector plus 4 times the second, I'll have my b. So 3 times the first plus 4 times the second is 2, 11. Agreed? So if I give you b, if I give you b coordinates, can you convert them into s coordinates? Look at this calculation. A linear combination of vectors as matrix times the column. So I can rewrite this as 2, 1, negative 1, 2. Based on what I have here. I'm not going to be looking at the picture anymore. So it's given this 3/4, and then I multiplied it by this matrix. Talked about this at the end of Wednesday's lecture. It's the type of problem I've just been giving you is take this vector and change it into that one. And anytime we're turning an input vector into an output vector, that's essentially a function, and we can describe functions with a matrix. So this matrix one more. If I tell you the b coordinates are 2, 3, and I want you to find the s coordinates, all the work can be done with a matrix. So matrix times vector is the answer. What's the matrix? In columns? 2, 1, negative 1, 2. Input vector?
2, 3.
And then the answer I'm looking for is what I get. You have a lot of stuff to write down. Got 1/8. So again, we're working with different coordinate systems to describe the same vector. I can describe a vector in terms of x, y, in terms of x hat, y hat. And we're practicing going between different coordinate systems. So here's the B representation of the vector. I want to find the X representation. And there's a matrix that'll convert the B coordinates into the S coordinates. The dual problem is I'm going to give you the S coordinates and ask for the B coordinates. Notice how this is slightly different than the problems I've been giving you. It's the problems I've been giving you before by converting B coordinates to S coordinates. And now I'm asking you to convert S coordinates to B coordinates. And we'll see your linear algebra intuition. If this is the matrix that converts B to S, how are we going to use this to get the matrix that goes S to B?
Yes.
Right. So the inverse is going to go the other way. So do you see that essentially I can rewrite this problem as the output is 5, 10. You want to find the input. Talked about how to do this. Remember how this works? It's 1 over the crisscross. So I'm going to do 4 minus a negative 1. And then I switch these two, so that's 2 over 2, and then I change the signs of those. So in general, gentle reminder, if I want to do the inverse of A, B, C, D, if I do 1 over, AD minus BC. Then I switch A and B. And B and C, I change their signs. That's just what I did for this example. Which is 2/5, 1/5, negative 1/5. So here's my matrix that'll take S coordinates and convert into B coordinates. So to solve this problem, take my S to B conversion matrix. This is the matrix that converts S coordinates to B coordinates, which is exactly what I want to do here. So I take that matrix, 2/5, negative 1/5, 1/5, 2/5. And then I'll plug in some S coordinates. Here's some S coordinates. Here's the matrix that converts those S coordinates into B coordinates. That's the that's 10.
2.
10 over 5 is 2.
What? What was I talking about? 10 over 5 is 2.
Yeah.
Like I said, plus another 2 is 4. Yeah, very good. And negative 1 plus 4. I'm going to go 3 on the second one. Okay. I'm glad you guys are here. Yeah, usually us teachers say that if it wasn't for the students, this job would be easy, but actually, I'm glad you guys are here. Okay, so the B coordinates of this vector are 4, 3. Let's do one more example. This is always fixed. This is always the standard basis for R2. And I'm going to pick my B basis depending on the problem I'm doing. Different problems will have different B bases. And remember, it's the columns of this matrix are the elements of my B basis. I make this matrix. Is this matrix again? Notice that the columns exactly match the vectors I have there. Is that my B to S matrix or my S to B?
S to B.
Good yes, but no. That's B to S. So let's talk about why. If I told you that the B coordinates of my vector were 3, 4, that tells me, that gives me the instructions for building this vector out of these basis elements. This means 3 times the first one plus 4 times the second. And if I wrote this in the matrix form, it's matrix times 3, 4. It's the columns of the matrix that do this. The definition of this is 3 along the x hat vector plus 4 along the y hat. And what matrix multiplication means is that this expression is a deviation for that. So again, what you're gonna the shortcut punchline is I'm giving you the vectors that make up my new coordinate system, and I can use those vectors to make a matrix. So notice that this is the column space of that matrix. And then this matrix either converts B coordinates to S coordinates, or it converts S coordinates to B coordinates. Which one? This is B to S. How do I find S to B?
Invert the matrix.
Quick practice, we're going to use the formula I just erased. It's 1 over the crisscross. So the AD minus BC here, C here is 2. And then
1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1.
So what does this matrix do? B to S or S to B? That is the S to B matrix. And what that means is if you give me the S coordinates of some point and you want to rewrite them in B coordinates, all you have to do is multiply your S coordinates by this matrix to get the B coordinates. So far, so good? Okay, now, and it's give you a problem to think about in Wednesday's lecture.
I have a question.
Yes.
How did you identify between the two of what it was, whether it was B to S or S to B?
So if you're given the matrix, you're given the basis,
right,
and you use those elements to drop into the columns, that's always B to S. And then the inverse is the S to B. Remember the horse show that I told you about? So I went to the horse show and I counted and I saw 80 heads. I counted, was it 120 or 240?
240.
I think it was 240.
What was it?
240. 240.
Yes, it was. That's actually a good point. I think this is what it was. What is it? 240.
It's 100 heads.
240 legs.
100 heads.
Some sort of STEM career, because that's true for most of you. And you have to be a bit careful. It's after you graduate from Laney, go to your four-year school, maybe go to graduate school, and then when you start doing your job, do you think a typical work day is going to be, hey, good morning, here's 20 derivatives and 10 integrals I need by lunch? No, you're going to be, here's an interesting problem that we're trying to solve, and then we're going to try to use some math to figure out how to solve it. The more tools you have in the box, the more ways you can have to tackle that problem. So I'm going to show you how an algebra student would do this. And then I'm going to use linear algebra to solve the same problem but give you a different perspective. So really think about this class as you're just getting a new set of tools or a new set of perspectives to solve problems. How many horses? How many humans? I don't know. I'll call it X and Y. And then I can use X and Y in two equations. The fact that I saw 80 heads, what's the equation?
X plus Y equals 80.
X plus Y is 80. And 240 legs.
2X plus 4Y.
Close. My X's were horses.
Oh, 2.
So 4x plus 2y is 240. Agreed? And then, you've been doing this since Algebra 1, system of equations, you know how to solve it. We also did it in this class. Now you solved it, Derek.
Yeah, but it was different. This one's 40 and 40, I think.
Oh, so it's supposed to be.
Last time was 100.
Yeah, last time it was 100 heads.
Was it?
Yeah.
Yeah? So these numbers are actually important, so. Translate it to 100. Okay, now what is it?
I don't remember.
It's 20.
What is it?
20. That is 20 horses and 80 people.
Yeah, I think that's right.
It makes sure this works.
Other way around. 80 people.
Does that work?
Yeah.
80 and okay. So again, it's back with the correct problem. There's the solution. Let me show you a linear algebra way to look at this. Yes. I'm going to look at a function whose input is vector where the coordinates represent number of horses, number of humans. And then, let me check one thing here. And I'm going to represent this 100 heads and 240 legs as a point into space. So each horse human input I get is going to give me a head leg output. So if I have two horses and one human, how many heads? Two horses, one human?
Three.
Three heads? How many legs?
Six.
No.
Ten.
I'm going with ten. Horses, okay, actually, here's a backup. Horses have four legs, humans have two legs, horses have one head. Is that ten? Okay, so the idea is this point, 2-1 in my input space, gets mapped to 3-10 in my output space. So if you give me a vector representing how many horses and how many humans, then I can give you a vector counting the number of heads and the number of legs. And my goal here is to end up as 100, 240 as the output. And then I'm trying to find the x, y input that gets mapped to that exact same point. So I'm thinking about this as a linear transformation, and I'm just trying to find the input that goes to that output. So if it's vectors to vectors, we can describe it by a matrix. What's the matrix here?
1, 4, 1, 2.
Okay, so how many heads? So how many x? Yeah, for each x, how many heads?
4.
And for each y, how many heads?
4.
So the number of heads is going to be 1x plus 1y. And then remember, this is horses, humans. And then finally, for the leg count, each x, 4x, and 2y. So way to look at our problem is find x and y. Such that 1, 4, 1, 2, x, y is 100, 240. And then when I want to push an operation to the other side of the equation, x, y is some matrix times 100, 240. What's this matrix?
Inverse.
The inverse of this. That's already a slightly different way of looking at the problem. I'm going to show you yet another way to solve this problem. Still on this problem. I'm going to make some new creatures. So instead of doing horses, humans directly, and as a hypercentaur, it is going to be one horse plus one human. So for a hypercentaur, what's the head count?
Two.
And the leg count?
Six.
And then an anti-centaur is going to be minus one horses plus one human. So an anti centaur is minus one horses plus one humans. So how many heads does an anti-centaur have?
Zero.
Zero. And how many legs?
Negative two.
Negative two, exactly. So I am trying to get to, what was it, 100 heads? And 240 legs. Well, each anti-centaur is going to give me zero heads. So the only way I can get heads is using hyper-centaurs. So how many hyper-centaurs do I need if I have 100 heads? So that's 50 hyper-centaurs. But if I have those 50 hyper-centaurs, how many legs do I have?
300 legs.
300 legs. How many legs do I have? 240, so. I need negative 60 legs. And then that gives me 240 legs. So how do I get negative 60 legs? It's 30 anti-centaurs. So, if I decide to solve this problem in the coordinate systems of hyper-centaurs and anti-centaurs, it's, we've got, what is it? 50 hyper-centaurs. Let's translate this into horses and humans. So 50 hyper-centaurs is how many horses?
50.
And how many humans?
50.
And 30 anti-centaurs is negative how many horses?
30. Negative 30.
Negative 30 horses and how many humans?
30.
So it's 20. So, I know there's a lot here, so this is a first draft, is I wrote up essentially what I'm doing here, so eventually this will be posted on Canvas and passed out, but I just wrote this up a weekend before last, so probably going to be easier. I saw a student's notes on this lecture and realized that there's too much going on to get everything in notes. This is just my write-up of what we've been doing so far. Okay, you don't really need to read through this yet. This is just my write-up of the lecture that I'm doing here. Does everybody have exactly one? So again, you don't really need to read through this right now. This is just so you don't have to take as many notes. It explains what we're doing. So I want to walk through this problem again, but this time think about the graphical representation of the horses and the humans and the hyper-centaurs and the anti-centaurs. Here's the original problem. my input space is the horse, all the horse human combinations, and my output space is heads and legs. And so I want to figure out which combination of horses and humans lands me to this point, which represents 100 heads and 240 legs. That's what we did. Is instead of working with this coordinate system directly, yes, I'm going to do it this way, essentially overlaid a different coordinate system where x hat is the number of hypercentaurs and y hat is the number of antiparticles. I'll go down here. And we first want to find an input point here that lands us to our goal. And the first thing we did is we know that we have to have 50 hypercentaurs to get our head count. So those 50 hypercentaurs get mapped to this point right here, which is 100-300. Okay, then it's when I add some anti-centaurs to my mix, that's only going to change the leg count. So if I went up by, how many?
30.
If I went up by 30 anti-centaurs over here, that corresponds to going straight down by 60 legs. So here is the picture of how I got to this point. As I first moved so I had the right number of heads, the right x coordinate, and then moving in the anti-centaur direction only changes the y coordinate over there. So let's call my hypers x hat and my hat, my antis y hat. I've got a matrix that's going to turn a hyper anti-center vector into a head leg vector. So for the head count, let's see. So each x hat, each hypercentaur gives me how many heads?
Two.
And each anti-centaur gives me how many?
Zero.
The leg count, each hypercentaur gives me how many legs?
Six.
And here?
Negative two.
So remember my original matrix was 1-1. And was it 4-2? Okay, but it was easier to solve the problem in the hypercentaur anti-centaur coordinate system because of this zero. So just to preview a bit and then go a little bit farther than we're going to go in this class. It's a lot of problems are going to have a matrix that represents a transformation. And instead of working with the standard basis, we're going to come up with a new coordinate system to make that matrix easier to work with. So this idea of putting the zero here, you're not getting enough linear algebra. Called the sure decomposition. I'm going to mention that at the end of class, but we're not going to pursue it. So, sure decomposition essentially says, given a transformation, we can make a new coordinate system where all the vectors are perpendicular to each other, and this matrix has a lot of zeros. So, it was easy to solve this problem when we're working with hypercentaurs and anticentaurs. But then the last thing we needed to do was convert our solution here into our solution here. So do you know how to convert between coordinate systems?
Yes.
You do. So our standard basis for this problem, like always, is 1, 0, 0, 1. And then let's describe our B basis. So what's a hypercentaur?
2, 6.
So in general, a hypercentaur is one horse plus one human. So our x hat coordinate here is going to be 1, 1. And our anti-centaurs are represented like this. How do I describe this vector relative to this coordinate system?
Negative 1, 1.
This says our hypercentaur is one horse plus one human. Our anti-centaur is negative one horse plus one human. And then I can make a matrix just by dropping the vectors in this coordinate system and as make them the columns of this matrix. Is this B to S or is this S to B? And when I got that answer of 50-30, so 50-30 was my answer over here. Are those B coordinates or are those S coordinates? So it was 50 hypercentaurs and 30 anti-centaurs. Those are B coordinates, right?
Oh.
And the original question was how many horses, how many humans? Because we want to turn those B coordinates into S coordinates. So what's the matrix way of converting B coordinates into S coordinates?
Multiply.
Just multiply by this guy. So this is already B to S. So I take this B to S. And we said the answer was 50-30. You guys are good at this. 20-80 horses. So again, by rewriting this problem as finding how many hypercentaurs and how many anticentaurs, it's easier to do in your head. And then once you have this answer, you convert it back into this coordinate system. That finishes chapter 3 for us. Let me just clarify. Oh! Nope. Yeah, we should probably do that. Yeah, we'll do that later. Okay. Oh, yeah, no. Oh, I got 5 minutes, right? Yeah, cool. Right on. Okay, so. You're going to like this. So to find the matrix that projects onto the line y equals 3x, is we did that already. As a warm-up, do you remember how to project onto the x-axis?
You just take the x.
Good. So if I take xy, and I want to project that onto the x-axis. What vector is it?
x0.
x0. So our strategy here we're going to make a new coordinate system where that y equals 3x is going to be our x hat. And then we're going to convert our original system into this new system. Now it's going to be a projection onto the x-axis, and then we'll convert that. I want the new x-axis, the x-hat, to be along the line y equals 3x. Can you give me a vector on that line? I'm going to go 1, 3. Everybody agree with that? And then, you can really do anything you want for y-hat, but the easiest is going to be if you make it perpendicular. Let me show you a trick to get perpendicular vectors. Is switch these two and make the first one negative. You see those are perpendicular now?
Does it matter which one's negative?
Does not. Project my xy vector onto the line y equals 3x. Project onto the line y equals 3x is, these are standard coordinates. I'm going to convert it into b coordinates. Then when I'm in the b coordinate system, I'm going to do a projection onto the x-axis. And I'm going to convert that back into standard coordinates. Step process, convert the standard coordinates into the new coordinate system, do a projection onto the x-axis in that new coordinate system, and then translate that back relative to the original coordinates. Used these vectors to make the columns of a matrix. Is that S to B? Is that B to S?
B to S.
Is B to S. You gonna get S to B? This matrix times xy is supposed to be x0. First row?
1, 0.
Second row?
0, 0.
So our process of projecting onto the line is to convert to b coordinates. the x-axis in this coordinate system. I can do that with the matrix. And then convert b coordinates into s coordinates. I can do that with the matrix. And if you do one matrix operation after another, you know, you can combine all those matrices together to get a single matrix. Yeah. I'm going to let you do that. So actually put these pieces together and rederive the matrix that's going to project onto the y equals 3x1. And we'll pick it up here. Then I'll give you some homework hints for chapter 3. Actually, I strongly recommend that you start looking at the homework for chapter 3 and notice where you're stuck, and then hopefully I'll get you one stuck in the hints. Office hours now?